play here in the Bay Area. SFPL encourage you to learn more about first person culture and land rights. And we're committed to hosting events and providing educational resources on these topics. And you can find that in the link. As I said, we have two more events with SF Neon and Tenderloin Museum. Next one, July 28th, Neon Matchbook. And that's a partnership also with Letterform Archive. Everybody loves them. And then we have our own favorite. He's still ours. We call him Jim Van Buskirk, who used to be the Hormel Center librarian. And he will be doing a presentation about celluloid and neon. And now I'm going to breeze through all of the amazing events that we do have for summer. Every Tuesday night, we have an author talk, June, July, and August. So please come through for that. And look at this. All of these amazing authors are with us. So it's going to be a fun summer. Saturday, we have the California Native Plant Society, always super informational. And then we have community presenter Linda Jackson, who will be talking about Black music in San Francisco. It is Black Music Appreciation Month in June. California Book Awards, Hay Day, I love Hay Day, and we are celebrating the magic years, Jonathan Taplin's new book, and he will be in convo with Grail Marcus. SF Arts Commission did a COVID in artist in residence, so they will be doing a panel. And so like you can see, we just have a ton of stuff. So we hope you will come join us in all of these virtual libraries. And in person, we are finally opening up. So rejoice, friends. And so tonight, I am really excited for, like I said, one of three and the book launch of Neon, A Light History. And I am going to turn it over to our partner, Katie, from the Tenderloin Museum.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to a book launch and discussion for Neon, A Light History. My name is Katie Connery, and I'm the executive director of the Tenderloin Museum. Thank you so much for having me. The Tenderloin Museum opened in 2015 with the mission of uncovering the lost history of the Tenderloin, as well as celebrating the vibrant present-day community. And we do that through historical exhibitions, an art gallery, walking tours, and weekly public programming. We're currently open 10 to 5, Tuesday through Saturday, with walking tours every Saturday at 1. So please come by and see us. You can also pick up a copy of Neon, A Light History there. The Tenderloin Museum is the fiscal sponsor of San Francisco Neon and our long-term collaborators and friends. And together we've collaborated on neon art shows, public programming, and walking tours. And we have an initiative with the city to restore neon signs in the Tenderloin neighborhood, called Tenderloin Neon A to Z. And we'd love it if you could join us for our next event with SF Neon and the San Francisco Public Library on Topography of the Matchbook, featuring Stephen Coles from the Letterform Archive on July 28th. This event is inspired by our 2019 publication of the Matchbook. And we, during that time, also produced an exhibition and public program series about historic matchbooks from the Tenderloin in the early 1900s, the 1950s. And we really discovered doing that project that you could really learn a lot about history through the aesthetics of the past. And I would describe matchbooks at the intersection of design art, advertising art, and nightlife history. And I would definitely say the same about neon signs. So the connection between matchbooks and neon signs, I think, was immediately obvious to us. And we collaborated with SF Neon throughout the exhibition on public programming regarding the matchbook and the ephemera exhibit, including the Topography of the Matchbook event, which was a huge hit. And we hope to see you for that presentation on July 28th. So without further ado, I'd like to turn things over to the authors of this exciting book, Paul and Dydia.
Further ado.
No further ado. Thank you, Katie. It's great to partner with San Francisco Public Library. Thank you very much with the Tenderloin Museum and, of course, with SF Neon and Randall and Homa and Al Barna. We're talking about our book today, and we conceptualized it from the outset as a partnership with Randall and Al, because they're great collaborators and we've worked with them in the past and have enjoyed how 2 + 2 = 6 or 7 or 8, whenever we do. So it's great to be here tonight. Thank you all for joining us. I'm gonna share my screen so that you can see our slides. Stand by. Thank you.
Technical difficulties.
Oh. All right. You should all be seeing the first slide. Somebody holler out if you're not, because now I can't see the chat at this moment. Randall Ann is going to be monitoring that for us, and we'll check in with your questions a little bit later. So I'll introduce myself, and then Paul will just introduce himself. So I'm Dydia DeLyser. I'm a geography professor at Cal State Fullerton, and I've been doing research and publishing on the American landscape and the California landscape for about 25 years. This work is a project that Paul and I, part of a project Paul and I have been working on for more than 10 years. And it's funded through generous grants from the Anders Foundation, the National Endowment for the Humanities, and the National Trust for Historic Preservation. Also, the book explicitly benefits the Museum of Neon Art and was conceived of as a project to benefit the Museum of Neon Art, where I serve on the Board of Trustees. I've also served in the past on the Board of the American Sign Museum. Enough about me, let's hear about you.
Yeah, my name's Paul. Just a regular old guy doing the best he can with the meager gifts the good Lord gave me, something like that. Not really true, but I've been working in the sign business since 1977. It feels like 1947. I meant to say 42 years. Started off by accident making neon signs and haven't learned. So move on.
All right. So one of the things that we really wanted to do in our book was to unite our very different kinds of expertise and use that to think about neon signs really differently. Partly, we unravel little known histories and correct some misunderstood myths in order to reveal how neon signs have transformed the American landscape and how they've helped us build community beneath their light. So we'll start from the beginning with how neon signs came to be, something that's widely misunderstood. And I imagine that some of you know something about neon's history and others may be new to it. So we'll try to reach both groups. Can I talk about Daniel McFarlane Moore?
I think you will anyway.
Daniel McFarlane Moore is really one of my heroes. It's he who really successfully made the first commercial luminous tube signs in the mid-1890s. This is long before most people understood that luminous tubing had been commercialized and had been made. He was working in Newark, New Jersey, and the New York City metropolitan area. What he did that was so amazing was make cold white light. So as you can see in the large photograph, tubes, glowing white tubes that could light a room without producing heat. Absolutely revolutionary. He also bent them into signs. And by 1910 or 1912, there were luminous tube signs lining Broadway in New York. Unfortunately, his patents were bought out by General Electric, who perceived him as a threat. So he was crushed. And then later in retirement was murdered by a jealous electrician. On the other hand, there's George Claude.
Keep going, you're on a roll.
No, he's for you. You get to talk about the evil guy.
I get to talk about the bad guy.
Yeah.
He's not really that bad. He was just, he was kind of the Edison of France. He patented things. He didn't necessarily invent things, but he capitalized on things and saw the use of them. So when he formed his company Air Liquide, one of the byproducts was the gas neon and the gas argon. And he petitioned for Daniel McFarlane Moore to put neon in more tubing, which existed in Paris. Now we're looking basically at more tubing that has been pumped with neon. And I believe that's 1911 or 12.
1910.
Okay. So much, much, much earlier than we think of as neon, the neon sign.
So, but the noble gases, neon and argon, really revolutionized the ability to make luminous tube signs. And in the US by the mid 1920s, signs under George Claude's patents and signs under the patents of a whole slew of American companies were competing and spreading all across the United States. But one of the origin stories of how signs arrived or began in the US is widely misunderstood.
Handoff?
Yep.
So allegedly for 50, 60, 70 years now, this photo has been proof of the original neon sign in the US installed at a Packard dealer in Los Angeles in 1922. He purchased from Claude Neon at the Paris Exposition. The word Paris, there is such a place as Paris, but that's about the only truth in the whole story. This picture was taken in 1929 or 1930, celebrating the new Packard dealership. If you move on to your photos, we'll...
So we did a lot of research to try to understand. We wanted to find a picture of that sign in its original location and used air photos to identify the sign. And then did a lot of research that showed us that that sign couldn't have been first.
The sign in question arrived in Los Angeles in December of 1925, which was about two or three years later than the original sign, the Ur sign, had shown up in myth.
So we found a series of dated air photos and then the original building permits, and were able to date the sign. You can see it does exist. So this is a close-up of the air photo, and it's blurry, but what you can see in this is a later version of other Packard logo signs, and the logo uses radio masts and radio waves to suspend the Packard logo. And then you can kind of, if you know that that's what they were doing, you can then kind of see a radio mast and radio waves and the Packard logo in the box. So that sign did exist, but it existed too late, not until 1925, too late to be the first neon sign in the United States. But then for those of you in San Francisco, look at this picture that we found, which has only, as far as we know, once before been published in another work of ours. This is the Earl C. Anthony Packard dealership on Van Ness in San Francisco. The building still stands, slightly remodeled. There's some really interesting signage on this building. Can you describe it for us, Paul?
Yeah, Dydia found this photo looking through archives and showed it to me, and I was playing old eagle eye, and I noticed that first off, this sign was electric. It's not a light bulb sign because it's too shallow to change any bulbs. So we did some more research, and we found that in the early teens in Paris, George Claude had made signs with glass faces and neon behind the glass face. And he was doing that in 1913, 1914, just prior to World War I. So it's not much of a stretch of an imagination to say that Earl C. Anthony bought these signs from George Claude at the Paris Exposition and brought them to San Francisco. Now, also in our research, we found a description of the original signs that Earl C. Anthony bought, and it said it was a large script of his signature, and below that was the Packard logo. Well,
so are these the earliest luminous tube signs mounted outdoors filled with neon gas in the United States? They could be. So
interesting sidebar.
Interesting sidebar. Perhaps some of you can find more information, more photographs, more about this sign. But let's move on. Let's talk about colors, because neon now, we know, with the neon we know today is all kinds of colors, but it didn't start out that way at all.
Yeah, neon originally was done with clear glass, and the only two colors that had any kind of oomph to them were neon, red, and argon, blue. argon itself was kind of a little bit on the light side, but you could put a little bit of mercury in it, which gave the oomph. So the signs up until the early 30s were almost all either red neon or blue mercury argon on clear glass.
So the 1920s to the early 1930s neon landscape was red and blue and red and blue. You had incandescent signs, but the neon was so much brighter. It really, really popped. The colors developed later in the United States, not until the early and mid 1930s. And the myriad colors that we have today were developed by using colored glass tubing and different colors of phosphor coatings on the inside of the tubes. And so those colors erupted in the mid 1930s around the US, and that's what created the rainbow that we see today. And it wasn't until then, until, well, 1938, they came. Oh, you want to talk about this?
No, I was just going to really quickly say that these techniques were all invented in Europe in the early 30s, like 31, 32, but they didn't work their way overseas until like the late 30s, 38, 39. And now you're going to move on to.
So remember, it was Daniel McFarlane Moore who made the first commercial luminous tubing, and his tubing was white. Well, white neon luminous tubing or mercury argon filled luminous tubing didn't exist in this country until 1938, when the Earl Carroll Theater debuted on Sunset Boulevard in Los Angeles.
Now, the Earl Carroll Theater was, at the time, a revolutionary idea because it was a dinner theater. And it was basically kind of a high-class burlicue show of the type that Earl Carroll had been doing for probably 25 years. What they did is they designed a building in the feeling of a World's Fair display building, like the General Motors building, the Chrysler building, just this giant block of cement. But to adorn the block of cement, they used neon. And you can see in the postcard that they're using neon bars that produces kind of a step effect on the front of the building. They're using a neon face. They're using a neon halo over the face. And then they're using fairly what we consider standard channel letters for everything else. The cool thing about it was the word theater actually flashed to read eat at the theater. Eat at the theater. Very clever.
Very clever.
Clever, clever, clever.
I get to talk about the geography. So
firewood ready, Gridley.
Thank you. So by the mid-1920s, two things were really coming together. One was the technology for luminous tube signs filled with neon or mercury argon. But the other thing was automobiles and together with hard surface roads. So reliable, affordable automobiles are from the mid-1920s widely across the US. And one reason why neon and cars went so well together was because of the way that neon tubing is bent in the shape of whatever letters. People understood that when you were reading a neon sign, you weren't reading a light bulb sign which connected a series of dots. You were reading the letters and the words themselves. You were reading the light as if it was searing directly into your brain. So neon was understood to be able to be read at greater speed. And in the automobile and aircraft era, speed was a real thing. In fact, the 20s were called the speed age, like we have the internet age, right? So speed was a really big deal, and neon was the forward-looking technology for the speed age and the automobile age.
But also, neon, part of the art skill of neon is taking a three-dimensional item and making it into a two-dimensional item by use of skillful bending and blockout paint. Well, when you're in a car, it reads as two-dimensional. You don't see the little zigzags and the whirly gigs and things like that.
Then with the Depression and and Roosevelt's multiple relief programs, a whole series of things influenced the development and spread of neon signs. So the first one was the repeal of Prohibition in 1933, which by 1934, every place wanted to advertise that they sold beer, and they were doing it with neon signs. So there was literally, in the Depression, a boom in neon signs that said beer. And then federal programs for relief, like the storefront modernization program that gave loans and grants to business owners in order to upgrade and modernize their storefronts, often with neon.
Just think of it, your name, John Law Beer.
That sounds good.
Sounds pretty good.
Yeah. I hope it's good beer. Then after the war, something else really significant.
I was born?
No, that's later. It is after the war.
It was after the war. I can't think of anything significant other than that.
I can imagine how that would happen. So FDR signed the GI Bill into law, which allowed returning servicemen from World War II, servicemen and women, to go to universities and vocational schools for free. And neon schools were one of the things that counted. So hundreds, if not thousands, of returning veterans went to neon school. And what that meant for the neon landscape and for the US was, at that time, if you had one skilled bender, the man who went to neon school, and his presumably his wife, the two people, their family, could start a small sign shop in a small city or town somewhere out on a highway and make a living and support their family. And so beginning after the war, you see the opening of hundreds and hundreds of small neon shops. Many of them are still existent today. You'll see founded in 1946. And you'll learn that a shop has been, you know, four generations in the same family.
And also the other thing that happened was in the early 1930s, George Claus patents ran out. And so that took the thrust of the business from the large companies that could afford the patent payments to mom and pops again.
Right. So by the 1940s, without those patents, a small mom and pop shop could absolutely flourish. Well, what is it that neon signs do? Of course, we often think of them as advertising, but what they really do is attract. So they work geographically. They draw people in. They draw people to your business or your product. So whether it's inside the corner confectionery on the left with their brand new post-prohibition beer signs on the back wall, or whether it's to the Richfield gas station and steak shop on the right, the signs are drawing people in. That's what most neon signs do, but they don't all necessarily do that, because they can equally work to distance and to keep people away, as was the case with this sign in Mobile, Alabama, famously photographed by Gordon Parks. The sign, by the way, has been preserved by the History Museum of Mobile, and it's been preserved broken so that it can never again be lit. But
well, I could fix it.
After so much success, by the 1950s and into the 1960s, things began to shift for neon, and neon became the object of some disdain.
The funny thing about this picture, this was in the San Fernando Valley on Ventura Boulevard, and it's obviously foreshortened just for effect. But I remember this all real well. I remember just thinking, wow, what a lot of stuff. This picture was probably taken about 1962 or 63. And almost all those signs are gone, except for right in the center there, Art's Delicatessen, still kicking away.
The deli and the sign.
Yeah.
So with this kind of sign density, it was easy for people to say, this is too much. So there hadn't apparently been sufficient regulation, and signs were trying to outdo and outcompete one another. And so signs became disdained, and a landscape morality that legislated and ruled against signs and specifically against neon signs emerged across the US, including scrap old signs campaigns organized by the sign industry itself, beginning in the mid-1960s, across the US. They would declare scrap old sign day or scrap old sign week, and take down broken and functional, owned and abandoned historic signs, neon and incandescent. We lost thousands and thousands and thousands of our historic signs.
That was part of Lady Bird Johnson's highway beautification programs, and it just seemed like a good idea at the time.
It seemed like a good idea at the time. So by the 1970s and into the 80s, neon signs were really becoming endangered. Could you talk about the technology and what was shifting?
You can see what's happening here is that the one on the left has neon lettering on top of the sign. Now, the AMF bowling one may well have neon in addition to the bowling pin, which is neon, but it would be behind the plastic because plastic became the thing. It was clean, it was easy, it was kind of a dumbing down of the skill set. You could make a box and slap a piece of plastic on it, run some neon underneath. Then that became, put a piece of plastic down and a fluorescent tube underneath, and now it's LEDs. So it's gone down, 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 down.
So with a de-skilling in the industry and new technologies, the plastic faces that became popular after the war and fluorescent tubing, lighting it from behind or LEDs, neon became more and more endangered. So not only disdained, but also literally endangered with components manufacturers going out of business, sign shops closing up, other shops closing their neon plants. But all this time, and for long before, neon has also always been art. And often we most often think of neon art in this country as having emerged in the 1960s. It's actually quite a bit older, with the work of Zdeněk Pešáňek in Czechoslovakia, who merged this new form in the mid-1930s, this new form of neon, this technological form, together with natural forms, in this case, a woman's torso, also a lot of tree and natural plant imagery, or the work of Lucio Fontana in Italy, who lit entire spaces indoors with his neon art. Neon art continues to be vibrant today, and I know Amy's going to talk about that. This is the work of Roxy Rose, who is a neon artist who also is a skilled sign maker and a highly skilled neon glass blower and tube bender, and works now to make art against oppression. But that's a good example of how neon signs are and always have been handmade.
Yeah, no one has ever figured out a way to have a neon sign made by a machine. It always has to be a person. It always has to have somebody blowing on the tube. It has to have somebody heating up the glass, bending it.
Whether that's Amy.
Oh, there's Amy. Yeah. Or Chewy.
Or Chewy.
Yeah, that's not Amy.
Or Chewy. And that's true. So that's true of making the glass, of bending the glass. That's also true of the way that the installations are done themselves. So the work that John does, well, he was working on a pre-neon sign, I guess, earlier today. And there's Paul working on a sign that appeared in Pasadena mysteriously behind a false front several months ago, and he's working to restore that. That raises one of the really interesting things. So it's made by hand, and it's still made by hand almost 100 years after they really proliferated across the U.S. using in almost exactly the same equipment. Really, it's neon's longevity. This is something that there is no way that Daniel McFarlane Moore or George Claude or anyone could have predicted this. Can you talk about these ones, Paul?
Well, the one on the left is Acme Beer, which was a California brewing company. This was probably made right out of the gate after Prohibition, 1934. It is, the Acme is neon, and the on ice is uranium glass with, I believe, krypton inside. It's very, very pale. These things have been working. This is on our kitchen table right now, and it's been working since 1934.
running the same gas, the same glass.
And the same transformer.
And the same transformer.
The Filippi signs, probably also around the same vintage, early 30s, still working. Some of the glass that's on there is from the 50s or earlier, still working.
Basically, it means, you know, those signs for Filippi's, they've been working outdoors at night. There's five signs on that business. They've been working outdoors at night for 90 years, 95 years. Yeah. That is a longevity that nobody would have ever imagined. And what it means is it also has not yet reached its limit, because neon will light up in its tube indefinitely. It doesn't burn. So nobody knows how long these signs might potentially last. So that brings us to preservation. The neon sign landscape, at one time, it looked like this. This is Hollywood.
Yeah, it was Hollywood and Highland. So, and this was, you know, atypical for any main street in a big city. Broadway, Market Street, Vine Street, Hollywood, Highland, they all look like this.
So at one time, neon signs were lighting our landscape with tremendous color and vibrancy. And of course, we know that that isn't the case anymore. Well, beginning in the 1970s, individuals and groups began to work to preserve neon signs. So for example, the Route 66 organizations in every state along the route have worked really hard to raise private money, grant money, federal money, to restore the landscape of Route 66 in totality. So every neon sign, every motel, every cafe, and the highway itself. And they have vibrant communities that that work to keep that landscape lit. We can see now that there's a whole neon preservation community, and that's been helped a lot by SF Neon and Al Barna and Randall Ann Homan publishing a book like Saving Neon, a Best Practices Guide, where people who are interested in learning how to save a neon sign in their community and how to get it done right, how to get it preserved, how to get it restored, relit correctly, can go to the SF Neon website and buy that book. But preservation isn't always enough. Because if you're sitting outside and you're a lit electric sign, you may need more.
This was the Hotel Californian, which was on 6th and Bonnie Bray near MacArthur Park in Los Angeles. The building burned down in the mid-1990s. And oddly enough, because of the Eagles song Hotel California, somebody thought Hotel Californian was close enough, we should save the sign, which was great. They saved the sign, probably for the wrong reasons. They saved two of them. That sign, the picture up on the top left, was probably taken 25 years ago, before they got really, really, really destroyed sitting in a park. A well-known actress got one of the signs and pretty much destroyed it. And then I was hired to restore the other one after it had been sitting outside for about 20 some odd years. Very, very, very bad shape. Stripped it, found out the original colors, remade all the metal, obviously remade the glass, transformers. It was one of the few signs I've ever had been able to work on where they gave us a permit to put a roof mounting on it, because that's a significant no-no. But because this was a city-sponsored project, they allowed us to do that. So this is me and my crew putting the glass on.
So fortunately, now there's an entire movement across the country where more and more signs are being preserved and more signs are being restored, and restored well and restored accurately. It can be quite a bit of work, as Paul described, for Hotel California, and we can talk about that more when we get a chance to answer your questions in the chat. But it shows us a little bit about Neon's community, the way that people are coming together. In the case of Hotel California, this was when the sign was relit, it was a big celebration that included, well, the crew, the residents of the building, the developer who built the building and paid for the work, the city council person, the preservation community. These are groups of people that usually exist uneasily side by side. They don't usually get along well together. And the Neon Sign Restoration Project brought them all together into something that they all supported. And neon signs in that way, that is the work that they can do. They can bring people together to create community. And this restaurant, Pans, down here in Southern California is a great example of that.
Yeah, the man who owns it is the son of the original builders and founders of the restaurant, who hired high-end architects to design it in what we now call the Googie style. But about 5 years ago, they went through a total renovation and brought it back to its original 1950s look, including restoring the sign, which I did.
So they did not leave out the sign when they restored the building and its interior. And that restaurant has a vibrant local following, as well as a vibrant international following of those who are really interested in mid-century modern and Googie coffee shop architecture.
The sign spins, by the way.
So all this to say that neon's light has been tremendously enduring and continues to be so. It vibrantly creates communities, bringing people together underneath neon's glow. And that, I think, is that's what I've learned, at least. Maybe you always knew that, maybe in 1947 when you were born.
Yeah.
You knew that coming out of the egg.
I probably forgot it already.
But you knew it when you hatched.
Yeah.
But so neon draws people together, and we mark moments in our lives, as the people in these images were obviously doing. We mark moments in our lives with our neon signs, and we're drawn to businesses that have neon signs. And that's always been the case, and it remains the case now. So we thank you for joining us and listening to us tonight. We look forward to taking your questions. We look forward to hearing what the other folks have to say. And we'll look forward to continuing to talk about neon, but I'll stop my screen share so that somebody else can talk.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Dydia and Paul.
And yeah, break that at your doorstep.
That's right. Well, and that we'll circle back to that. But really what we want to talk about is how honored we are. I'm Randall Ann Homan.
This and I'm is Barna.
And we are the designers and publishers of this
Neon,
wonderful book that Paul and Dydia wrote. And where can you get this? You can get it at the Tenderloin Museum or at Green Arcade Books or online at sfneon.org. And thumb through it, really, just so people can see how packed.
Oh, look at how's that?
It's got a clown with a drum that says liquor. So you just got to get this book, right?
Historic images.
Yeah. So we're just showing this book off a little bit. We loved working on it, and it really is just so easy to absorb. An amazing amount of really fun history about neon and America, for that matter. But enough about the book. I'm going to share our, are you still showing something?
I start reading it.
Okay. I'm going to share our, we have a quick little PowerPoint here for you. We also just want you to know, since we think most of you are San Franciscans, that there is an organization in your city that works to rescue signs that are about to go into the dumpster. And that's us. We're San Francisco Neon. We wouldn't exist without the Tenderloin Museum. They're our physical sponsor. And we work with Katie in the Tenderloin to save signs, but we also save signs in the Excelsior and Russian Hill and Chinatown. We do walking tours and we'll bring those back probably, I don't know, January 1, is that a good day?
Maybe after New Year's.
Yeah. So we're all about saving signs in San Francisco. So that's what we do. We're at sfneon.org. And we also publish books. And these are our four titles that we've published. And San Francisco Neon was the first book. Then we did the Neon Icons book. And that was a joint publication with the SFPL, which is awesome.
Yeah, it was a great experience.
And then we started working with Dydia and Paul. And they wrote the introduction to Saving Neon. and then neon light history came next. So if you have room on your neon bookshelf, we can help you out. All of these titles are pretty fun, and you know where you can.
And if you can always build a neon bookshelf.
You could build a starter set. You could. All right. So we want to talk about our favorite page in the neon light history book. And it's the one that has the beautiful Lipo Lounge sign. And if you haven't been to Lipo Lounge on Grant Avenue in Chinatown, it's really a place for locals. It's not a tourist place. And they have one of the most unusual signs. And it's a 3D Chinese lantern. And this was fully restored through a grant from the city, matching grant by the Aero Sign Company. And it really represents in the book, like the other picture, which is a fully restored sign that was done by the Museum of Neon Art in Chinatown in LA. And these are just some restoration projects that we're so proud of, and so proud that the communities come together to make these happen.
Right, and we're talking about page 69 and 70 here.
Yeah, if you want to bookmark those.
And the thing that I appreciate about those two pages is what a nice breakdown Paul and Dydia have done discussing sign preservation and restoration options. I think that's really helpful for people who maybe are a little overwhelmed with what you're supposed to do with an old neon sign on your business or that's in your family. I think they really break it down nicely. And the book, these pages also include a great explanation in regard to the difference between collectors, neon museums, and offsite neon installations, as opposed to onsite preservation efforts. So page 69 and page 70 serve as a real guide for contacting organizations, and it just definitely makes people aware that there are people and there are organizations who are available to give you advice and consult and help you preserve or save a neon sign in your community.
So it's not just a history book; it really is a reference book, and one that we just thumb through all the time. Okay, so.
Yeah.
Next, we wanted to bring two of our local neon aficionados to be on this panel, and because they love the book.
That's right. So I'd like to introduce you to Amy Palms. Amy is an artist, a neon artist, a tube bender, and is also the owner of Rebel Neon. Her shop is here in San Francisco, and if you need neon repairs done or neon signs fabricated,
Call Amy and we'll put her website in the chat. Right. All right, Amy, you're on.
All yours.
All right, thanks everybody. Thanks Randall and Al and Tenderloin Museum and Dydia and Paul. That book is so great. I love it. And I just wanted to talk about page 63, which has Roxy Rose's art on the cover. Randall's putting it on. Yes, and this is meaningful to me because I went to art school. That's where I learned how to do neon glass bending and neon art from the great Fred Chita. And then I left art school and wanted to continue working with neon in my art. I like to do mixed media with neon. And so I started working in different sign shops. I went to Michigan for a while and worked for a sign company there. And I got into a few group shows here and there. And then kind of got a little bit disillusioned with neon. I felt like when I put neon art in a group show, people were drawn to it as kind of eye candy. So I started getting embarrassed by that. And I started really pulling away from the art world and kind of honing my craft, trying to learn glass bending as a sign maker. And I did that for a number of years. I lived in Michigan, worked there, and then I moved to San Francisco in the late 90s and worked for a few sign shops out here. And it actually wasn't until 2017, Shauna Peterson actually introduced me to Meryl Paticky, who was curating Women in Neon called She Bends. And she invited me to participate in the San Francisco show, and I kind of got this spark back in me to make neon art again. And that's where I saw this piece here by Roxy Rose. It was, the photo doesn't do it justice. It's magnificent. It was in this room and you walk in and there's this huge, it's gigantic and it's slowly spinning and it's political and it's about love and it's, I don't know, it just blew me away. So there was another piece there by Roxy as well that also was amazing 3D self-standing art, and it supported itself. And so what I wanted to say about Roxy's piece is she grew up making neon her whole life, neon signs, then got into art, and her art is political. She talks about transgender issues, Asian hate, Black Lives Matter, and she puts it all in neon. And when you see a neon sign, it's kind of like, it's very powerful because it's, you know, it's words in neon that make you just, I don't know, neon signs, like they tell you that signs are like rules, right? They have a lot of power. They tell you where to go, what to do, what not to do. So when you see something like Roxy's art, it just is really wonderful. Getting back to She Bends, when I got into those shows, it changed my mind about making neon art. I kind of got into it, especially being in a group show with other artists who were also working with neon in their art. It didn't feel like I was standing out for making neon. I guess that's pretty much it. I if you have any questions, just let me know, but that's all I have to say about that.
Okay. Thank you so much, Amy. And yeah, we are ready for you guys. If you've got questions, we've got a couple, which we are going to answer after the next panelist, but keep those questions coming. And Amy, thank you so much. Thanks for your beautiful artwork that's behind you. Thanks for showing that off.
Yeah, thank you, Amy.
In the Zoom. And thanks for joining us tonight and focusing on Roxy. We're big fans of Roxy Rose too, as are Paul and Dydia, which is why we put such a big picture, because that is an amazing piece. And hopefully we'll bring that back to the Bay Area and we can show it off again, as well as the rest of the She Bends. And there's a great link, shebends.com or .org. And you can read all about that Women's Neon Artist Association, which is pretty cool.
Pretty amazing.
Yeah.
Group of people. All right. And now I'd like to introduce our next and final panelist, Mr. John Law. John is a longtime Bay Area sign man, and apparently is also the owner of the John Law Brewery. So John, the floor is yours.
The floor is yours.
Wow. Okay. I don't know about the brewery, but I first have to say thank you so much to everybody who's contributed to this presentation, to the book, and to basically the ongoing efforts to preserve neon and neon lighting and the history. And I'm going to start with the SF Library. I've been a big fan of the SF Library since the days of the Iron Librarian, Gladys Hansen, in the 70s, still doing good work there. The Tenderloin Museum and Katie doing amazing work on the history of that neighborhood and beyond, and supporting Randall and Al and SF Neon, which is fabulous. And I can't say more good things about. And of course, the Museum of Neon Art down in LA, and Paul and Dydia for making this amazing book and doing the work that they do. I gotta say, I mean, I'm a sign hanger. Like Paul, I got involved in the sign trades back in 1947. Wait a second. Oh shit, pardon my French. It was actually 1984. And I'd been involved in sign making since 78, commercial signage, little door signage, and lawyer's office, that sort of thing. And then I was looking around and I thought I could make more money working in the neon trades. And so I got into that through various means. And over the ensuing decades, I've had the incredible great luck and good fortune to be blessed to work on some of the biggest and most amazing neon displays in the Bay Area, from the C&H Sugar sign in Crockett, which is still there, to the Canadian Club board down on 1001 Brannan Street, visible from the freeway. I worked with Paul Norton at Service One Signs and Federal Sign. We did the restoration on the rotating neon star on the Sir Francis Drake Hotel back in 1999, I think it was. And it's since been taken, the neon's been taken off of it, very unfortunately. And I hope that that changes at some point in the future. I still keep my small business central sign services. I still keep the Port of San Francisco sign going. The Hills Brothers Coffee sign, which we did a complete restoration, including replacing rotted out sheet metal. Paul Troutman and I did back about 15 years ago, and it's still in great shape. And so I really relate to Paul a lot as a fellow sign hanger, serviceman, a sign maker. And he's worked on some amazing signs in Los Angeles, which being a bigger city has more neon displays back in the day and still some that are still existing. And I know he's worked on some really great ones. There's so many stories. I mean, the history of neon to neon and electrical sign makers is handed down. It's a verbal history. It has been, which is why this book is so amazing, because Dydia and Paul have dug up so much information, kind of countering some of the popular myths that you'd find if you're a sign maker, such as Claude Neon basically inventing neon and coming out with it. Great to find out that that this guy, Daniel McFarlane Moore, who is from New York, actually the first guy to use illuminated tubes in the way that he did, and actually did signage 25 years before neon became popular. And that was something I learned from reading this book that just completely blew my mind. It was counter to what I'd been told for decades, really. And I had great good luck to work for a couple of major sign companies. I worked for Federal Sign Company as a young apprentice sign hanger. Actually, Shauna Peterson started as a glass spinner there about the same, a little bit after I started as a sign hanger and serviceman. And so the stories are handed down. For instance, sign guys and gals now would communicate before you had your little iPhone that told you where you were going, you know, two little dots coming together on a screen that would explain to you how to get from point A to point B. Sign guys would communicate on how to get from one place to another by signs. So for instance, you would say something like, oh, you go down there, you go down that way, you take a left at the big Union 76 rotator, and then you go a few blocks down and you see that big skeleton tube job on the side, you know, with cerise glass, you know the one I'm talking about. And then you take a right there and you go about 10 blocks down, right? And then there's that big, City of Paris, tower, and you take a right there, and then you're at your location. So that's how we would communicate on how to get from place to place. And so I don't know what to say about the sign trades. I was very fortunate to get in them. It's the best trade to be in if you're going to be a tradesman. It's way better than roofing, let's put it that way. Over the years, I was also fortunate to be involved in some capacity for many years in the underground San Francisco art scene, and ended up at one point incorporating neon into some of the work that I was doing, prominently designing the first neon skeleton for the Burning Man, which is one of the things that I did back in 1990, 91, first years that we had glass on that structure. And I've also worked in some other capacities, but I'm primarily a sign hanger and a serviceman. And like I say, that trade is it's by far the best one in so many ways, because you're incorporating. I mean, you get to move around a lot. I mean, there's so much spoken about, and rightfully so, about glass benders, tube benders, as we call them. And what an incredible trade to learn how to do and to apprentice in and to become good at. I mean, I always knew that it took several years in a production shop, from what I could tell, to become a real quality glass bender and have really good clean bends and welds. But then taking that and into art, as Amy Palms and other fabulous neon artists have, incorporating those two things. And I tried to do that a little bit in my time. And I don't know what else to say. I mean, the book is amazing. I really liked the entire book and learning about the history of neon in ways that I didn't know, and like filling out certain areas I was a little bit sketch on. And I particularly liked the restoration work that you'll find later in the book. I think starting around page 67 or so, Paul and Dydia get into the actual restoration work that they and other people have been involved in on signage. And having done some resto work myself, I can really appreciate that and the work that goes into it, the skill and time to really do it right. Because, you know, neon signs, when they first came out, were much cheaper than the old incandescent bulb signs that had been popular, you know, since Edison took over that whole field back in the 1890s. And so neon came in, it was much cheaper. It's actually an ecological move forward because you use much less power, as has been commented on, than the old incandescent bulb signs. And so in that way, it was a real advancement, technological advancement. In many ways, it was helpful. And also just the quality of light that you get with neon is very different from any other light source that you might use. I mean, particularly these later day, you know, LED lighting, which is, you know, very functional and cheap and easy to do. And before that, you know, in the 50s, when incandescent lamps came in and plastic face signs, which, you know, there's some art and some artifice in those signs as well, for sure. You know, and there's some sign historians that have gone into that as well. But it's just interesting seeing a trade that was so disparaged when I first came into it, because there was this whole idea in city planning back in the 70s and 80s from academics and city planners that neon signs and lighting in general were bad things to have on city streets. And it was a whole aesthetic or an anti-aesthetic that came about and suffused city planning departments. And there was a real, you know, they really kind of put down neon signs, and it became unpopular and considered to be D-class A sort of, and which is really nuts when you just look at it on the simple, you know, idea of looking at these signs and how much artifice went in them, how much art went in them, how beautiful some of them are. So for some knuckleheads to, you know, in academia to decide that there is some real problem with them aesthetically just kind of shocked me as a tradesman, you know, an unschooled tradesman without a college education. It just seems silly to me that people could see this. And so now with people like Randall and Al and Dydia and Paul coming out and really pushing for the, you know, the resurgence of the appreciation of the aesthetics of neon signs, it's about time. It's way over time. We've lost so many great signs, so many classic signs, and they're expensive, you know, compared to other things to maintain and service them. But it's so valuable to do so. And so all I can say is just to end up here, I don't want to keep rambling on, but I'm so happy about this. And I strongly recommend anybody out there to buy this book, read it, learn more about this history, the architectural history of our country, which is so amazing. And so much of which we've lost and that which remains should be preserved, I think. And people should pay the money to do it and get you know, governments and grants and private industry involved in understanding the value to our culture and our architectural heritage from us. Yeah. Anyway, that's all I got to say. Thanks for very much for having me.
Thank you, John. Yeah, thank you so much. We're going to move to questions now, and we've got questions for every single one of you. But while you're on, John, before you leave, one of the questions was could you talk a little bit, particularly on the signs that these big landmark signs that you maintain, which I believe is starting with the Oakland Tribune Tower, and right. If you could name the other ones and what it takes to keep them going.
Well, like I say, it's not like roofing. It's actually kind of fun to work on big exterior, spectacular signs. It's, as Paul will certainly, agree, it's a lot of fun. It's hard work. It's physical work. It can be tough on your body. So I maintain currently, I've kind of dialed back my business quite a bit. I no longer go into, you know, malls at, you know, midnight to install, ugly plastic signs anymore, like I did for much of my career as a sign hanger. I've kept, service work on three spectacular signs in the Bay Area that I still work on: the Hills Brothers Coffee sign, which, as I mentioned, we restored, 20 years ago and it's still in great shape. The, Port of San Francisco sign on the ferry building, which is a classic sign. I mean, it's in the opening scenes of, you know, Streets of San Francisco with Carl Malden and Michael Douglas. I mean, it's probably the most visible sign, certainly one of the most visible signs in the state, maybe the country. And I maintain that still myself. And the Tribune Tower sign with the neon clocks and then wraparound four-sided neon letters, Tribune letters. I've been maintaining that. We have an issue with that right now. I've got a circuit out, so there's some letters out on it. That's typically not the way it is. So if you have to take a look at it, we're fixing it. It'll be back and 100% burning hopefully next week. But okay, so for the only sign job that I still work on in a bosun's chair is a Tribune sign. A bosun's chair is a little seat about that big that you sit your butt in and hang on some ropes in front of the sign. And I have to do that in order to get it to neon clock handles, the hour and the minute hand. Now, the Oakland Tribune building is a singular building, and the signage on it is singular. And the clocks and the clock arms, there used to be more of them, certainly back in the 20s and the 30s and 40s, but I can't find hardly any other examples in the world of neon clocks that have neon on the minute and hour hands. And there are four of them on this sign. And that's quite rare. And the wraparound letters on the 16th floor, 11 foot tall neon letters that say Tribune. Also, that's quite rare. They're cantilevered out from the building. Quite rare. The building architecture is unique. It's a fabulous building. It's actually the most fabulous building in the state for my money. And I am blessed to be able to work on it and try to keep it going. It's a bit of work. It's a lot of work.
And you should also, is your office still behind that clock?
I have a teeny weeny little office. It's about as big as your bathroom up on the 22nd floor, two flights above the last elevator stop. And I've been through six owners of the building now since 89, when I first started working on it with Steve Bagley. When I was at American Neon Sign Company, I started my business with Chris Radcliffe in 1992, Central Sign Services. We had some megalomania in our idea about starting a business, so we wanted to call it Central Services, right? Which we did. We actually got the idea from the movie Brazil. And yes, my office is still there on the 22nd floor. I keep my library there. I do my paperwork there. And you've been there. You know, it's a great spot. You know, I'm very, very fortunate to have it. Six owners of the building. The new owner of the building is a super cool guy. He understands the arts. And I have the same deal with him that I had with the other five owners, which is I keep the neon going for a pretty sweet deal in that building.
That is a sweet deal. So when you guys drive past the Oakland Tribune building, John's up there, or the Port of San Francisco, or the Hills Brothers, we can thank John. Now, this is a great segue to a question for Paul and Dydia, if you guys can come on. One of the questions that we had in the chat was this whole idea about why neon signs. Well, what we hear people say is burn out, but we never like to say the word burn with neon because
of course,
they don't really burn out. But what does happen when they fail? What causes that?
Well, there's so many causes of neon failure. The most common one nowadays is that the transformers that are made are terrible.
Awful. I hate them.
The GFIs they put on them are awful. And every sign I install that's new, I say, you know, if this lasts a year, we're doing good. If the last 5 years, you're doing great. And if it lasts 20, I just worked on a sign the other day, I put glass on it, 1940, had the original transformers in it, still works.
Yep. Yeah, you betcha.
Nowadays, every year I get a call saying, hey, our sign's broken, and it's always the transformers. So mostly it's the transformers. Sometimes dirt, mud, junk get inside the housings, and they can burn an electrode. Sometimes a burnt out sign, what they're calling a burnt out sign, is nothing more than that the mercury is cold and isn't circulating through the tubing.
And that's sometimes they put a drop of mercury in.
You put a little drop of mercury in it, and you roll it around so it vaporizes and it burns.
And that makes that particular blue that
it enhances the blue. So mm-hmm. What'll happen is sometimes you'll have a thing that says John in script, and the top of the J will be dim, and the OHN will be bright, and people go, "Hey, my sign's burned out."
That's so you haven't blamed pigeons yet, Paul.
Oh, pigeons. Ooh.
Pigeons are terrible on signs. Yeah. They're so hard.
You'll never meet a sign hanger or a sign service man who will profess to liking pigeons ever.
Because they will actually land on the tube and even break it sometimes, right?
No, what happens is when sloppy service guys will open up the access panels and they either won't put them back at all, or they won't put them back right. And the pigeons go, hey, this is a nice, dry, cool place.
It's a perfect birdhouse. Yeah.
Until
the sign turns on and they get electrocuted and die and decompose inside the sign. And layers of dead and decomposing pigeons build up inside your sign cabinet.
Yeah, but also they nest in them.
Yeah, up to two. I pulled, as I mentioned earlier to you guys in the preliminary thing, I pulled two 55-gallon drums of pigeon detritus out of a nameless sign in the Tenderloin one time.
I worked on a sign. It got shipped to me from Kansas, and they sent me a picture, and they had it shipped, And when I got it, luckily the fronts, the faces were porcelain, so they were good. But the whole inside of it, which was regular tin, was eaten up by pigeon poo. And it just, you could just pick pieces of the sign off and there was nothing left because the pigeons had rotted it away.
So the decaying carcasses plus their urine and feces, it all turns acidic. And then in the presence of water, moisture, rain, snow, it accelerates the decomposition of the metal. And so both Paul and John talked about how they both had to rebuild the metal sign, they're called cans, the metal sign cans, because over time the metal itself can corrode and decay and rot out. So there's a whole series of reasons. You didn't even mention the wiring yet, but the wiring, the insulation eventually gets brittle and so the wiring can also fail. There are a whole series of reasons why neon signs can fail, but that said, they can also just as well succeed and not
and
fail.
just last and last and last and last. Like
we all know
cosine has been there since what, 40, at least 47. Yeah.
We all know that pigeons are malicious.
Yeah. And we were going to give pigeons their due in this talk.
But you know, if you stand under a sign that's missing some of the access panels, if you stand long enough, eventually you will see a pigeon stick his neck out, get a look at the street, everything.
I worked on a sign on a roof here in Los Angeles and from the 1920s. And the first thing I had to do with that sign was get a drumstick and pound on it for about a half hour. Drumming drumstick. I had to get a stick and pound on it to get all the birds out of it. I could hear the sign going,
okay, we have a question for Amy. And then after that, there's one for Dydia. So Amy, are you still there? Can you come on?
Hi.
Someone wants to know about that beautiful ribcage sculpture behind you.
Oh, thank you. That's a piece I made a couple years ago. I was kind of getting into making interior body parts with neon and bones and stuff. And this piece right here, I had been, at the time I was listening to this intense podcast from the Canadian Broadcasting Company about consent. And it was just really vivid the way the person was describing the story of being touched without giving permission, but not necessarily denying the person. And it just spoke to me. And so this is kind of my interpretation of it, where it's just like a heart beating inside a rib cage.
Yeah, so now that we can see a little bit better, we see that flashing heart inside. And yeah, give us a little bit closer look. That is just beautiful. How long did it take to create that? Is that time consuming, all those bends?
Yeah. For me, like it's a little bit harder to do 3D, which I don't know if you can tell on the screen, but it's there's three layers. This is the spinal column, and then the heart, and then the rib cage kind of curves around this way. So it's kind of, you know, usually as a sign maker, you have a pattern that's in reverse and a screen on top, and you bend the glass and place it on that pattern, and it's all flat. And then you pick it up and it's the correct version of the sign. But when you're doing 3D, you kind of have to bend in space. So it's a little bit more tricky. It took me, I don't actually know how long it took me, maybe a week or so, I guess.
Well, it really turned out beautiful. And I also love, neon has this quality that the light will be very different. The light that's coming from it, depending on the ambient light, like it's just always changing as the light changes in the room.
Actually some ambient light over here. I've brought my neon suitcase.
All right.
Different colors.
That's wonderful.
This
And is that what you would show potential clients if you're going to make a custom piece for them?
Yeah, actually these days, with especially with COVID, I found a couple websites that are pretty good at showing the color. It's not exactly as good as seeing it in real life, but if you're just communicating through email, you can kind of get a gist of what color they want if you just show the, give them the website and they can pick a color.
So,
but it's not as much fun as opening the suitcase.
As opening it. And so I just kind of want to point out, this is a suitcase that you made that from scratch. Is that right, Amy?
Yeah, I wanted to mimic the old, you know, sign seller, you know, suitcase person going from door to door trying to sell neon.
And that's a great segue back to Paul and Dydia, because you guys collect those salesman cases, if I'm not mistaken.
Well, I guess we accumulate as many of them as we can find, but they're pretty hard to find. But I think we have four.
Yeah, we don't collect, we just attach two.
And then keep using them.
Well, they are really cool. And you guys have brought your vintage ones when we've done live events at the Tenderloin Museum.
Yeah. The nice one we have is like a European one from the late 30s that's all covered in wool on the inside.
Yeah, I have to say,
oh, wow.
Paul and Dydia were so cool. I guess about 2 years ago, they actually drove up with this suitcase from the Los Angeles area to San Francisco for an event we did at the Tenderloin Museum.
Yeah, no, that was very cool. So we're getting close to our allotted time, but there is one kind of technical question going back to history now. And this was very early in your presentation, Paul and Dydia, and that was about the patents that got bought out. I believe it was Daniel McFarlane's Moore. And so somebody want to know, like, how does that work? How do you buy a patent from somebody else?
Anything is for sale for the right amount of money and the right enticement. So I'm sure because General Electric was the one that bought the patents, they just probably made them a really good deal.
They also hired, so General Electric not only bought Daniel McFarlane Moore's patents, they also hired him. And he became head of their Moore lamp division. So what they did was they sidelined his patents, his technology, and his luminous tubing in order to, and this is fairly common corporately, and General Electric is notorious about it. There are whole books about General Electric and their business practices in this time period. They would, you know, it's basically a hostile form of hostile takeover. With patents, you can do that, and that's one of the things that they did. Patents, of course, also expire, and the length of a patent's life has changed over the years. So, like when George Claude's patents expired, that was a shorter time span than the time span we have now. So everyone thinks of gaining a patent as this really great thing, and it's yours forever, and it's not. So it's a very competitive work environment, especially in lighting technology in the late 19th and early 20th centuries. There's actually a friend of mine is working on a full book on the history of patents. So it's a whole separate area.
And also, it's kind of like songwriters don't really own their songs forever.
Right.
But also around 1910, 1912, when GE bought him out, there were new technologies, tungsten. So the color of light from a light bulb was way better. So he was starting to feel pressure and he wasn't doing as well.
Right, his technology was just a little bit past its peak. So he wouldn't have necessarily been entirely opposed to being given another chance and a bigger laboratory and a different podium.
Okay, I have a wrap up question for our session, unless you've got something about patents.
I don't own any patents.
All right. So this is a question that came in for us, but I actually want to ask it of all of you. And that was, how did you fall in love with neon? So I would say for Al and I, we loved it since we were little kids. It's something we really remembered. Like John was saying, it's like it was landmarks in the cities that we grew up in.
Right. And then we grew up and we met people like all of you. So
Like a lot of photographers, we set out to document the neon signs of San Francisco and the SF Neon book, and then you become advocates for the things that you document, but we didn't know that there's actually a whole world out there of, and actually a national movement.
No, we had
to
no
appreciate
idea.
This particular art form, whether it be art or signage. So let's go around. So we'll go down to you, Amy, next. How did you fall in love with Nia?
I would say I have a love-hate relationship with Nia. But, you know, I didn't know until I went to art school that it was all handmade. And then I got into it and I kind of, you know, I was drawn to it because I could work on it as a, you know, I tried glass blowing and you need a partner. And I really like the idea of neon being like a singular loner kind of activity. And then, as I said before, I went and I tried to make art and be in group shows, and then it felt embarrassing that people were just drawn to it because it lit up. And then I honed my skills, and you know, I didn't have the internet, so, and people were really secretive about how they did neon. Like, it was like people wouldn't share information, so I would like read signs of the times and spy on people, you know, try to learn and figure it out. And you know, I kind of got my footing doing bombarding for a long time. But anyway, I'm back to loving neon, and I'm really into this book. I mean, it's just, I love the exposés and, you know, the how terrible Georges Claude was, which I don't know. We can talk about more of that if you want. But anyway.
Or read the book and find out.
Yeah, read the book. It's really good.
All right. Thank you, Amy. Thanks for joining us.
Yeah. I want the long version and I want a hardcover.
There you go. Yeah. All right. How about you, John? What's your love story?
Good question. And the first time I really became aware of neon, I'm sure, of course, I'd seen it around as a kid and whatnot, but in 1978, I was in a group called the Suicide Club, Urban Exploration Group, and we used to do pranks and street theater and climb around urban climbing and stuff like that. And a good friend of mine who was in the group, who later ended up becoming a noted architectural historian, and he's a little bit shy about his name being used, but he came up with this idea when the City of Paris building on Union Square in San Francisco, they had a giant neon Eiffel Tower on it, and they were going to tear the building. And Neiman Marcus, which, you know, I have to be careful here. I don't want to curse. Neiman Marcus bought that building and we're going to tear it down completely. And we're literally forced by architectural historians and local history groups to save the rotunda in the building and move it forward as an architectural element in the doorway to the building, forced to do it. And then later, of course, those people took credit for that as though it's some idea that they had. Anyway, before this all happened, they were going to tear the building down. And so my friend had this idea, and he conscripted his friends in this group, this Urban Explorers group, and he made a giant banner that said, "Save the City." And we climbed up on top of the building and we hung this banner from the top of the neon, this neon Eiffel Tower down to the corner of the building. So it said, "Save the City, call." And we had Diane Feinstein's home phone number. Okay, somebody got it somehow, and it was called the mayor. And we put it up there, it made the papers, and it was anonymous. Nobody ever knew who did it. And while climbing, I was a climber, and while climbing on this Eiffel Tower, I realized it was a, you know, neon. I'm like, wow, this is crazy. Look at this thing. And it just stuck in my mind. And later when I had the opportunity to join the neon trades, that was one of the big reasons that I developed an interest in it.
You had a very intimate, like physical introduction to the beauty of neon. That's great. Mm-hmm. Thank you, John. And thank you for joining us. Really appreciate you having me.
Thanks, John.
Thank you for having me. I'm honored.
Great to see you again.
Yeah.
All right. We're circling up to the authors.
Go ahead. You're first.
No, you're first.
No, you're first.
You can keep it a secret. You can say
read the book. 47, Paul.
Well, okay. I'm first. For me, neon was always evocative of the 1930s, and I was always a history omnivore. And one day, probably in about 1976, I was driving down one of the main streets in Los Angeles, and there was a place that said custom neon. And I went, really? That's interesting. So I walked in there and met the guy that owned it, that was the glass bender, and got to be friends with him. Around that time, somebody said to me, I was making jewelry, and somebody said, "You make great jewelry. Can you make us a sign?" And I went, do you want a neon sign? They went, sure, why not? So I made them a neon sign, and it was kind of a, what we would now call an out of the box type of sign. And it became real well known. And so people started asking me to do more. And I've been doing it ever since, and I still haven't gotten good at it.
Some other people might beg to differ, Paul.
I'd argue with them.
Well, I got interested because I fell in love with Paul. So he was one of our earliest dates in 1986. He was repairing a neon sign on the front of a Chinese restaurant, and I was, you know, hanging out, and we crawled through the attic to the front where the sign was. And I just thought this was the coolest thing. I just was completely fascinated by seeing how it worked, and seeing how he repaired it. And that's where it started. It's your fault.
It's my fault.
Wow.
It's always his fault.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, that is a great wrap-up question, whoever asked it. And again, we're just plugging the book. I think you'll really love it. It is compact and wonderful. You guys did an amazing job squeezing this history into very easy to read format.
And the more
it was a partnership between the four of us, because the text began with design in mind. So we were working with Randall and Al from the very beginning in how to conceptualize everything, and then all the way through. And their design is key to the way that the concepts and the ideas come across. So it's
And thank you for all the visual research too.
I think people should know the level of, or the amount of research that you've done, and the traveling, you know, all the shoe leather and the plane rides, and you know, it's just that it's years and years and years of research and knowledge that you put into that book, and it really shows.
And we want to give a little, a big thank you to SFPL for having us tonight. It sounds like that they have books on order to place on library shelves, or to sell through the library website. So order your
18 on order that you can place on hold for circulation.
Hooray.
Oh, okay. So you can check it out, or you can buy it from all those locations that were mentioned.
Yeah, Tenderloin Museum is definitely another one. And so we were going to go out tonight with a little teaser for the cinematic San Francisco Neon event. And this is a homage to neon and film that Al and I, well, we just painstakingly, I guess we need an obsessive.
Well, after we did our book, we needed to do something else with neon. So this was it.
This was it.
And this isn't, the short version.
Yeah. And so we'll, this is a little 2-minute film that really shows you, in some ways we think of it, the history of neon, where it started as glamorous, and then slowly in film, you can see that neon became less than glamorous. And actually there's a little bit of, murder and mayhem. Mm-hmm. And it's where neon is actually really sort of doing the work for the cinematographer. And we're going to go over this in detail in the cinematic SF Neon. Okay, I got to find it. Here it is. And we appreciate everybody showing up tonight.
It's been there, right?
That's it. Yeah. Okay. Here is Stolen Moments.
And thank you, everybody. It was a great evening.
Nick, I've seen many a side of my time, but that's the daddy of them all. I certainly got to hand it to you.
Why, Frank?
Well, there I was trying to get the old one fixed up, and already you'd seen the neon salesman, and bingo, a new sign prettier than a Christmas tree.
Thanks, Frank. Did it make you hungry?
Uh-uh. Thirsty.
Sure, celebrate.
All right, up. upstairs, folks. What are you waiting for? What's a half a dollar in your young life? Upstairs. Upstairs, folks.
You haven't eaten for days. Let's go to Fisherman's Wharf. I'll order a meal that'll last you for a week.
Right. Thanks, Paul and Dydia. Thanks, Amy. Thanks, John. And thank you to the SF.
Right. Thank you, Public Lisa Library. And Anissa. Thanks so much for having us.
Thank you, everybody and library community. We thank you for being here tonight. And definitely tune in July and August for SF Neon Returns.
More neon. Take care.
Neon. Sleep well, everyone. Thank you.